Welcome to the journal. As you can probably tell, we're not coming at you from our normal set, but that doesn't mean the show's quality will falter in any way.
That's right, Jake. From all of us here in our bedrooms, this is the journal.
Welcome. We've got quite a show for you here today. We got magic, we have dragons, we even have a musical performance by singer-songwriter Liam Slingerland. And we've got a good list of things for you to do with the newfound time everyone's got, given the current circumstances.
Yeah, but before all that, we've got a doc that will give everyone some context for the rest of our show. Our resident expert, Jake Wingle, is going to give us an explanation on how the nerdiest game in the world, Dungeons & Dragons, actually works.
Don't forget to tell them about the book.
Okay, so everyone out there who...
You only need one book to get started. And with it, you can make so many worlds, and you can...
Jake! Are you about to recite and give away the entire feature?
He's got a point.
Fine.
So, without further ado, Jake's guide.
Into the unknown.
Oh boy.
Yeah.
D&D started off as a tabletop strategy game originally called Chainmail. This was a tabletop war game focusing on medieval combat. In 1971, Gary Gygax, the creator of Dungeons & Dragons, released an expansion for Chainmail, with rules for magic and fantasy, in part based on the series The Lord of the Rings. The focus then turned from combat to character, and this became the Dungeons & Dragons First Edition, more commonly known as D&D, and has progressed from there. The game is split into two groups, the players and the storyteller. In the case of Dungeons & Dragons, the storyteller is also known as the Dungeon Master. The Dungeon Master presents a story in which the players play a role they create, hence the term role-playing game. The kind of characters one can play are in many ways endless. The rules provide a variety of avenues known as classes. After that, choose from a sizable list of different races one can be, such as elves or dwarves, and that creates your character. Next, we need a way to apply the rules to your character. This is done through their attributes. Attributes are the categories that define your character's capabilities. In Dungeons & Dragons, there are six. These are strength, how strong your character is, dexterity, how agile you are, constitution, how resilient you are, intelligence, your book smarts, wisdom, your awareness, and finally, charisma, which is how convincing you are, though many players misplay it as a measure of attractiveness. All this is a long-winded way of explaining that you can build your character however you want them to be. The rest of the gameplay is quite straightforward from there. You, as the player, present to the Dungeon Master what you want to do. They in turn assign that task a difficulty, usually ranging between 15 being an average task and 30 being an impossible one. You then roll a 20-sided die, more commonly referred to as a d20, and you take whatever number comes up, adding any relevant modifiers. For example, when lifting a heavy object, you would add strength. When solving a puzzle, you would add intelligence. You then present the number to the Dungeon Master, and they tell you how successful you were. The only exceptions to this rolling system are when you roll either a 1 or a 20. If you roll a 1, this is considered a critical failure. This is basically a combination of bad luck and fate, resulting in the worst possible outcome. Contrary to this is rolling a 20, which is when you, through sheer luck, are able to accomplish something that would otherwise seem unreasonably impossible. Nerd culture as we know it today began sometime around the 60s, heavily influenced by Gene Roddenberry's Star Trek and Tolkien's novels. These works were incredibly popular. However, as time went on, people wanted to experience and live in these worlds, and so they would write their own stories, especially before the advent of the video game industry. What they wanted was a way to experience fantastical worlds, which is what role-playing games were ready to provide. Dungeons & Dragons was, and still is, a very popular escape. With the recent release of the game's 5th edition, Wizards of the Coast, who are the current publishers of Dungeons & Dragons, streamlined the game to a great extent, which helped bring in new players without the need to understand years of convoluted rules.
Honestly, I've heard about the game quite a bit, but I never really knew what it was about. Seems kind of fun.
It really is. We should play at some point. I play every week. You can come join one of my sessions if you want.
Yeah, definitely. Mike, you recently started playing the game, right?
Yeah, I did. I wouldn't say I started playing the game. That would involve, more than once. I'm not quite sure that I'll be invited to that table again. Don't get me wrong. What I learned, for those of you at home, was, I'll let our viewers at home decide.
These guys are totally late. Okay, you told me this was...
Yeah.
Your costume's on the chair.
No.
All right. I don't know. You gotta be freaking kidding me.
No.
Okay, so we'll start.
So, first we focus and meet the cast of our documentary.
Right. I'm Constantine. I will be your dungeon master today.
Yep. So, I'm Adrian de la Cruz. Today I'll be playing as a half-elf monk called Mark.
So, my name is Barvik the Third. I'll be playing Alex.
So, my name is Jakub Wendel. Today I am playing...
Back on track, Neil. Okay, who am I? I am Michael Taylor.
Next, we set up a character. I've been assured it takes less time as one grows more familiar, but after seeing local wildlife setting these things up, this process deserves its own university degree. Why? Here's real time.
To cast it, or its attack range?
Then you're babied, and then we get our epic tale.
Okay, so, the world that we're playing in is called O'Earth.
One does need to be careful, though, with how long they spread out the intro, or you can lose a character, for example. This guy is getting bored.
They're going to start things off.
And it's not getting any better.
You being invited onto Baron Nehelim Rain's sail barge.
Our dungeon master was reassuring, though.
I will tell you what to do to be successful. Roll your d20.
Then my first roll.
One. I am perceiving he must have spiked my drink.
Where are we? He didn't even have a drink.
After questioning, one will find they do get better.
Dexterity, how am I at pickpocketing?
That is your main pickpocketing one, so you can go ahead and try pickpocketing someone.
Okay, I think that's a great idea.
Need strategies.
Whoever he tries to go pickpocket, I'll just go to them and be like, whoa, did you see those two people fighting? Okay, so this will give you advantage on your pickpocket. You get to roll twice and take the highest.
Okay, sounds good.
Went better.
Okay, so that's critical. So that means that you automatically succeed. All right, so you get 76 orins.
See?
What the? All
right, Mr.
And take it from here.
Why is it so
tight? What does false life do?
It's you can Romeo and Juliet someone where it looks like they're dead.
Get down here!
Hold it here!
me, you didn't let the other place.
Okay. Now, did you just decide that randomly, or is that actually a rule?
Just decide.
Let's hustle him.
That's a two. The guard will reach in and pull out the bag of cocaine.
It is a brown, bloody wooden box.
After a few hours, I began to finally figure this thing out.
I met you briefly. I'm going to get on the train because there's a nice ballroom to the car that I want to sit at.
Yes, it's very lovely.
Yes, this man is going to the cargo hold. And when he's there, he's going to find that box, Sheila, because if we get back to Canterbury and he doesn't have the bloody box, I might have him executed by the queen.
While all this is going on, I'm actually going to do a line of cocaine.
And that's the game.
So, my host.
So, how did you like it?
Well, let's see. Today I bet on a goblin fight. I then left that to pickpocket somebody. Then I lied to a police officer while cocaine was planted on another human being. From there, I switched my accent to English to get everyone onto a train due to a fare shortage. Lying about my career as a museum operative. Is that normal?
No, I think you're just a bad guy.
Fair enough.
Okay, Danny. What did you think about the magical journey we just saw?
Is that really how you play the game? Is that how it's supposed to be played, Mike?
How the heck should I know? Where's that one guy?
Who?
Oh, you mean...
Yes.
Wait. Is that person you were telling me about that,
Now you're getting it.
The main event.
Oh... Okay, so this is a guy who's an actual professional dungeon master. This guy made a career out of leading all of this.
Right. If anyone besides Jake or Mackenzie, wherever she...
No, Mike, hold up. You're going to give too much away. But yes, we have for our viewers to wonder in awe at John Dempsey, the world-renowned professional dungeon master.
What is a Dungeon Master? In the context of Dungeons & Dragons, the famous role-playing game, a Dungeon Master is a world-building player who acts as a god of the D&D campaign. They breathe life into the role-playing world. Being a Dungeon Master requires memorizing rules, player attributes, and stats of characters and different monsters throughout the world. The Dungeon Master is the keeper of rules and a seriously organized workbook. Sometimes it's hard to find someone who's willing to do this for you. Enter John Dempsey. John Dempsey is the first ever known paid dungeon master.
My bonus is my regular action. I'm going to hit him with my flail.
Okay.
And that is a 17 to hit.
Yeah. Just before I started doing this as a business, I had one particular summer where just everything was going bad. I was thinking about how I was going to pay rent that month. And I'd just recently been playing a game with my friends. And I was thinking to myself, well, man, I wish I could just play Dungeons & Dragons for a living. That'd be cool. And I thought, what if there were, people that were new to the game that either didn't understand it well enough or didn't have the time or the desire to learn all the rules or whatever? What if those people just wanted to hire somebody to come in and run a game for them and then leave again? And so I thought, this might be a good way to get some money on the side, the odd time on the weekend or something. And so the next day I you know, I knew my company name already. I sat up late thinking about it. I put up ads on Kijiji and Craigslist and told all my friends and family about it. And they were all like, John, you're crazy. No one's going to, like, pay you money to play Dungeons & Dragons. And so I waited.
This way. And about 1,000 feet width.
Yeah, my first year, I spent a lot of time making the sets. And at first, it was really basic cardboard stuff made out of pizza boxes. And now I do a lot of stuff with a hot wire cutter on foam, and so I can do more three-dimensional sculptures and so on. Yeah, it takes a while. It takes a bit of time. But, you know, like, once I get the sets built up, over time, you know, now I'm at the point where, oh, you want a Viking scenario? Okay, well, I know I got to take that set with me, you know, in my box, and then, you know, whatever else I'm packing for that scenario. So yeah, this is a real popular setting we use, the Yawning Portal. In the game, it's in the city of Waterdeep, and it's this mysterious place where everybody comes together to gather and learn rumors and job opportunities and adventuring contacts and so on. So I think for me, it's kind of an escape from reality, really. You know, you get to go to a magical place and be someone you aren't and explore another character and possibilities and fantasies and what a lot of people are attracted to it about. It gives you an opportunity to be something you maybe always wanted to be or fantasized about, or just to get a break from reality for a while.
My first time I've ever played was actually the first session that we played with John as our DM. So John just happened to be super patient with us and just helped us learn and essentially address any sort of questions that we had as they came up in session and outside of the sessions. But I mean, there's just so much effort put into, like, all of these little pieces that are put together and that we get to actually, like, interact with. Like, it's super, it's tactile, right? When we get to see what's actually going on, it makes things a lot easier for us to imagine the whole experience.
Now, that was awesome. Did you guys see the amount of time this person must have spent with all the towers and the figurines and the whole thing?
I know. I mean, right? Look, okay. He was giving us some background on this when we were, you know, meeting with him. Apparently, there are others in the world who have, props and costumes. But, I mean, this guy literally had to strike the set, to borrow the theatrical expression. I mean, as though there were actual scene changes.
It was awesome. And he tells us that apparently people call him from across the world wanting for him to be their dungeon master. Everything was just so cool. It was awesome.
Yeah, well, you know, Jake, right now, you also have the time to do all those figurines and create all those other things too.
Yes, right. I get you, Danny. You know, now that we have some time. Well, it would bring us to our next segment, actually, guys. Somewhere out there is our buddy, David Topless.
And he's going to show us a window into what he's been doing since the world shut down. He said that, well, everything he's been putting off is now on. Is that a real expression?
Well, I don't know, Jake, but I understand it. Dave's been breaking the slump that we've heard all the doctors talking about, and he's really shown up, not down.
Danny, I think you just told the audience that Dave is in lockup.
I'm so bored. I've been in my bed for a month now. I'm gonna get bed sores if I don't do anything. I can't even do a proper headstand. What's wrong with me? Have I lost that much muscle? Oh, this. My to-do list. I completely forgot about this shit. I guess now's as good of a time as any. What's wrong with me? I haven't even put on proper clothes in a month. It's just been shorts and a t-shirt. How did I let it get to this point? Now, what should I anime? Maybe hockey? This season isn't going to continue, is it? I guess I may as well continue it on my own. Alright, not bad for a first attempt. So what's next? Cleaning? That's so much effort. I gotta open these blinds, make at least a little bit of light in here. It's been pitch black. Oh god, it's so messy down there. Alright, time to get to work. You would not believe how hard this card is to take up. It's unbelievable. Took me a good 15 minutes. Alright, well I'm done with that. I guess I have to go to what's next. Relearning French? At least I don't need to move much while doing that.
Où est le restaurant? Salut.
Salut, bonjour, comment ça va?
Ça m'a fait plaisir. Au revoir.
Au revoir.
Alright, I'm still pretty rusty, but it's at least better than doing nothing. Alright, so I'm finally done. Alright, let me just check how long this is gonna last.
Well, there you have it. I guess he was tired after, you know, creating the whole doc. I don't get that.
Well, that's an interesting way to break out the slump that he's been having, but I guess we all cope in different ways.
Yeah. You could say that. How are you guys dealing with it?
Well, I've busied myself with a multitude of different smaller things. I got myself a while ago a tarot deck. And I thought it would be like, so what I've been doing is just reading through the little instruction booklet, trying to figure out how to read tarot cards. I heard that another one of us might have been reading about tarot cards, though.
Me! Yeah, I got myself a deck last week as well, and I've been venturing to the world of divination and that kind of stuff. It's been pretty fun.
What, did you guys pick up tarot cards in Scotland or something? Like, what the heck?
Oh, well, I picked up mine in Scotland.
No, I picked up mine on Amazon.
Well, our wonderful overlords now in this time of nothing but delivery.
Yep. Oh, well, they do deliver.
Speaking of other things that were delivered, another thing I got delivered recently, which was all lots of fun to get delivered.
He picks up a baby, I'll never stop laughing.
Something I've been looking forward to for a good long while.
Michael Jackson. Wait, no.
Nope.
Oh, good grief.
To round out my Star Trek cosplay, I got a really, really nice, high quality jacket. Oh, and
that one is nice.
Just to add, the finishing. You're
practicing your line too, haven't you?
What, engage?
And/or make it so?
Make it so.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah. Oh, and it's so comfy. And it's so warm. It's so nice. I love it.
You put that on.
You look really cool with it.
I feel really cool with it. Last thing I've been working on is the little command clips that they have on the, like, on the collar. But paint is still drawing on that, so. Anything else you guys been up to?
Yes. Like we mentioned, the tarot decks, I've been reading a lot. It came with a book and everything, explaining which card, what it is, and all the ways to spread the cards, and what does each way to spread the card and the combination of cards mean. It's actually a lot more complicated than I thought it was going to be. I'm going to be honest, I haven't done a reading at all yet because it's a lot, but it's been pretty fun learning and just trying to do small things with it. And I've also been planting a lot of stuff with things that you have on your house that you eat and then seeds come out or you have to cut it off.
Right.
For instance, do you know you can grow your own avocado tree?
Oh, look at that.
Damn, nice. Yeah.
You just put the pit in water with sticks and wait for weeks, apparently, because this one has 2 weeks and there's this tiny little bit of root coming out yet.
Cool. Well,
yeah. And
Mike,
those are the,
like, he's run off to go get something.
Yeah. Those are also the basil that I bought a plant and I cut it off a few pieces of it, put them in water to grow roots. And little guy, look at this.
Awesome.
Yeah. Now I just plant it on the ground and I have another plant of basil.
Yeah, so I assume repotting is coming sometime soon.
As soon as we can actually stand outside in the balcony without freezing to death. Yeah.
Oh boy. Spring is supposed to come sometime soon.
So, we've all been busy? I don't know. I mean, I love what you guys have been doing with all the tarot cards and that sort of magic. Actually, we do have a magical doc for everyone.
Oh, magical as in like more tarot? Or do you mean psychic?
No. I mean literally magical. Up next. We've got a documentary from Mackenzie Floyd about the wonderful Rosemary Reed.
Hmm. Put up in front of you like this, about this far apart. And on the count of three, we're going to do this. 1, 2, 3.
When I was really little, I had a dream like at night about magic. And so I woke up, I told my dad about it, and he had a card magic book. So he gave that to me, but I was maybe 10, so it was a little too complicated. And so we ended up at one of the toy stores and got a box set of magic, you know, with all those tricks that toy sets of magic have. And so I learned those, and within a year, my dad heard about Magic Camp on breakfast television. It was called Sorcerer's Safari Magic Camp. I like to perform close-up magic, which consists generally of smaller groups. And I also do what I call stand-up magic, or some people call it parlor magic. It can be done for larger groups, but it's not big stage illusions like sawing a woman in half. I use a lot of volunteers in my magic. I really like magic happening in their hands. They just haven't seen a magician in real life. There's so much online, so many videos. Obviously, most people have heard of David Blaine. They've maybe seen a special, but in person, I mean, I always ask people, have you ever seen a close-up magician? And I get a lot of no, or at least not this close. I was really fortunate because although I went to school on the East Coast, my magic community was always here in Ontario. This is where Magic Camp was, up in Haliburton. And so I knew the community very well. And I was also unique in being a woman magician. There were very, very few, if any.
Facing the same direction, turn yours around a little. Exactly. Now it's time for the magic. Here we go. 1, 2, 3. And lift up your two. And we should be facing.
It took me a long time to see myself as a trailblazer in a field. So I didn't spend a lot of time thinking about that. It was more so, and especially when I first started in magic, when I was first going to camp the first few years, I didn't even know that there weren't many female magicians until people told me. More so than not being included, I think some females, myself included, would have experiences of almost having too much attention put on them. It can just be a lot. You know, when you go to a magic club meeting and you're the only female, and then they all decide to use you as their assistant for their magic trick. And then many of them come up to you after the meeting and, you know, just, it's well-intentioned generally, but it can be a lot, especially if you're young.
So why aren't there more women in magic?
I'd produced a video on why aren't there more women magicians. And so I just thought it is the same, that's a way for me to communicate something that I think more people will appreciate and connect to than just a basic magic trick. Because they can find that if they want it, but they can't find what I did. You know, I'm the only person who did that.
And you're gonna do the same thing, but keep it going? Oh my gosh, thank you so much! I haven't even done anything yet! Wow!
Well, that was amazing. It's really sad, though, to see yet another industry with such gender discrimination. But it's very empowering to see a woman rising up and fighting against it.
Agreed. I mean, here at the college, I've been learning how we need to put that sort of message out there and amplify it. You know, send it all the way around the globe for everybody to hear, that sort of thing.
Well, as our show is wrapping up, we are going to leave our viewers with a special treat.
Oh, you mean Mr. Slingerland?
Yep, presenting to you our singer-songwriter, Liam.
And with that,
thank you, everyone.
And stay safe.
Hi, guys. Thanks for tuning in. My name's Liam Slingerland, and I'm going to play you a song by Paul McCartney. I'm amazed at the way you love me all the time. And maybe I'm afraid of the way I love you. Maybe I'm amazed at the way you pull me out of time. You hung me on the line. Maybe I'm amazed at the way I really need you. Maybe I'm amazed. I'm a lonely man who's in the middle of something that he doesn't really understand. Maybe I'm a man, maybe you're the only woman who can never help me. Maybe won't you help me understand? Something that he doesn't really understand. Maybe I'm a man, and maybe you're the only woman who can never help me. Maybe won't you help me understand? And maybe I'm amazed at the way you're with me all the time. Maybe I'm afraid of the way I leave you. Maybe I'm amazed at the way you help me sing a song. You write me when I'm wrong.